I'm Vic Iyer, CIO Marketing Services. With Windows 10 end of support drawing close, now is the perfect moment for savvy tech leaders to consider refreshing their PC fleets. Investing into the right kind of devices can help businesses innovate, become more secure, and better adapt to new ways of working. And perhaps more importantly, they ensure businesses have a foundation from which to implement crucial AI-driven improvements that boost both productivity and innovation. In this CIO webcast with AMD, we will aim to help IT leaders understand how to update their PC fleet in a new age of innovation. And before we delve into the conversation, let's find out more about our speaker, Michael Nordquist.
Yeah, Vic, appreciate it. As you said, my name is Michael Nordquist, and I am the Corporate Vice President in product marketing of our client group at AMD. I've been dealing with PCs, I guess, for the last 25 years. Really, the focus the last 10 years has been on commercial PCs. So spend a lot of my time talking to IT folks, talking to OEMs, talking to OSVs, really understanding what some of the pain points are and how we can help solve them.
Thank you, Michael. And I guess I'd like to start by trying to get maybe just a snapshot from you on what you're hearing from IT leaders and similar as they seek to evolve their PC investment strategies in, as I mentioned, this sort of new age of digital innovation.
Yeah, and you mentioned one of them right up front, which is we have Windows 10 end of life happening, you know, in October. People have seen that. They know it's out there. They know it's coming. They're looking at refreshing those PCs. But we're kind of in a unique space where a lot of folks in 2020, you know, had an unnatural refresh where they refreshed a lot of their PCs. Now, those PCs are coming up. They're coming up at 5 years old now, some of them 4 or 5 years old. And they maybe don't have the budget to refresh all those, but they want to find a way to refresh those PCs. Because when they look at their end user install base, they know the number one tool for employee productivity is a PC. So they want to give them something that they can do to be productive. They're also hearing all this buzz on AI, right? It's everywhere we turn in the news. And they're trying to figure out, is that something I need to jump in now? Should I be waiting? How can it help me improve the end user productivity? And then really, how can it help me improve my productivity? I still have my challenges with managing PCs, with securing PCs, have those operational challenges as they go through. And so they're looking for something that solves those traditional vectors as well. And that's really kind of been our focus as we look at our rising AI Pro PCs is how do we build that commercial class PC that gives you the benefit of the traditional vectors that you have from a PC, but it also gives you a base to build from as some of these future AI capabilities come up.
Yes, Michael, we'll certainly be talking about those AI capabilities later on, but security also comes out as a repeated high priority in our CIO studies, even if it might not always be the most glamorous topic, perhaps as AI. How important is it that PCs are protected? And what's the latest technology facilitating that?
Yeah, and I think if you saw a lot of the research and some of the details from Microsoft on the newest OSs, really the primary factor for them was, you know, getting security improved. How do we improve security? As you said, unless you're a security nerd, I fall into the security nerd category, so I like security. There's been a lot of innovation that has happened. And if you just look over 1 year, you might say, well, there's some improvements. But if you're actually looking at that install base that I started with, the 2020 PCs, there's been a bunch of big transitions that have happened over that time. And I could easily argue that the biggest reason you should look at refreshing a PC is just for security, even if you've got nothing else out of it. And there's been a lot of things that have happened. I'll list out kind of a few of things that we have. One is just this big move to virtualization-based security that Microsoft made that really raised the bar for the endpoint, where it made it much more difficult for hackers to attack a PC, and it protected a lot of the secrets that are on the PC. Now, in response to that, we worked with Microsoft to figure out, as they secure it on virtualization, what can we do down in the hardware and BIOS to protect those hackers from getting underneath? And so we worked together, adding capabilities, and what people will hear is the Secure Core PC program that Microsoft has. So working together with the OS, with our OEMs, as well as the hardware to make sure those hackers don't get underneath the OS. The next thing was there's a big attack surface where people would go after the browser, and they would find different ways through what was called ROP attacks to attack the browser and get in through that. Now, software alone wasn't able to fix that. And so we worked together with Microsoft and industry to implement something called Shadow Stack, right? That helps protect what was once one of the number one vulnerabilities of the browser. Then we looked at, hey, as PCs get stolen, how do we protect them, right? If someone gets a hold of it, how do I make sure I've protected my data? We added encryption in what we call memory guard. So if it gets stolen, it's much more difficult to hack into that system. And then we're also looking at the future saying, what are things that are coming? What are kind of capabilities with AI that we want to have? And we put Pluton into the system, which is hardware-based security to support some of those future AI usages. Now, the cool thing about all these security things is not the names or what they do. What we hear from IT shops is, I want that capability, but I want it just easy to deploy and easy to support. So all these capabilities that I talked in that have really come in since 2020, so they're new in the last 4 or 5 years, they're just built into all of our Ryzen AI Pro PCs. They integrate seamlessly into the OEMs or the latest version of the OS. So really, we make it almost zero touch for the end user to have to do anything to take advantage of these. It will see that the hardware is there. It will already be turned on. You'll have the capability as the software becomes available to just seamlessly integrate and not heavy lifting of trying to configure a provision or do anything else. It's just there.
Now, Michael, managing enterprise PC fleets is also critical for security, but also productivity in an age of globally distributed and hybrid workforces. How is PC management changing in next generation computers and devices?
Yeah, and we get that question a lot, and we've seen a lot of change. I feel like pre-COVID, things were marching along. It was console-based management. And really, in 2020, we saw the really fast transition to cloud-based manageability, more phone-based manageability of, you know, how I update PCs as they're out into the fleet. Then we saw the switch to how do I deploy them easy? So once I got them up and running, it was great. But as people get new PCs and put them into their hands, how can I make it easier? And we've seen a huge switch from what was, you know, IT wipe and replace, where they physically ship the system to an IT department. They would wipe the system, they would load on an OS, the applications, and then they might even actually physically require the end user to come in and configure and set up that system before finally giving them the system. Now it's really moved to a real seamless deployment. A lot of cases using tools like Microsoft Autopilot, where I can actually just ship the system directly from the OEM in many cases, all the way to the end user and have them securely and easily build that PC up and get it up and running. And so we've been working together with our partners to make that really seamless as we go through. Now, we've also seen people looking for out-of-band capabilities. That means if something happens to the OS and it's down, can I still access and potentially fix that PC? And that really came to the forefront last year with what we'd call Blue Friday, where there was an issue on some of the Windows-based PCs where they couldn't easily get up and running. And so we offer that capability where we can actually remotely boot that system and get it up and running and into a healthy state again. So we've got that capability built into those Ryzen AI Pro-based PCs. So we really have that covered. So that sounds great, but we have a lot of customers that are saying, I don't know, like I've got a business process set up with my current provider. I'm worried bringing AMD PCs in might be disruptive from a business process perspective. And so we kind of went and looked at it as, why would you want to transition to AMD? And we actually did some research here and said, well, what are just the cost savings, right, as you look at it? And so we did a study. It was based on a company of about 25,000 people, so a large IT department. And they found that when they implemented the AMD PCs, it's estimated they would save $50 million. And that was primarily from better productivity from the individuals, as well as lower acquisition costs. So that was something that really drew the IT departments to say, wow, this is something I should consider as I go through, just from a dollar and cents perspective. And as we started looking at, well, what about the manageability business process from the provisioning to deploying to supporting to retiring those PCs, it was pretty much identical versus what they would have with a competitor system in-house. So really that transition to manage those PCs, really not a big transition cost at all. And then there was a ton of savings from just an overall productivity and acquisition cost. So we've seen a lot of customers looking at that saying, hey, that looks super interesting. I want to give this a look. I'm looking at making a transition.
Thanks, Michael. Really, really interesting insights there. Now, I did say we were going to come to those AI PCs because it's obviously a major development as part of this AI revolution that we are experiencing. And we did touch on the new way of working that's going on in the global enterprises and other businesses right now. So I thought perhaps we could first look at how emerging technology like that's in these AI PCs can support the future of work.
Yeah, I think the big transition as you look at an AI PC was you added an extra processing unit, which is called an NPU, a neural processing unit, into it. And that was really designed to run AI capabilities. Started out really small. AMD actually led that transition, was the first x86 platform with a NPU in it. And then we've seen that grow over time. Now, the experience has started off very basic. So it's things that we're doing now, like video conferencing, background blur, maybe some basic transcription. You know, some nice benefits weren't earth-shattering benefits, but it allowed you to turn those things on without really impacting the battery life in a big way, right? Before, you might be able to do it on the processor, but it was going to, you know, cause a big spike in resources. And so this really brought that down. Now we've seen the transition, and Microsoft has talked about this in some of their Copilot Plus PCs, where it's kind of the next round of experiences. So we're leveraging things like large language models to do things that help us create as we go through. It used to be, you know, basic capability of trying to do transcription and notes, to meeting summarization, to actually creating emails, to actually creating presentations. It's even gone a step further now where you can do things where you just add in, you can do a text and you can create video just from typing in what you want to see. You can create a video from scratch. So it's really evolving fast. And some of the verticals like software development, it went from kind of a novelty a year and a half ago of how I can use AI to help generate code or validate code, to if you're not integrating AI into your software development practices, you're just not competitive anymore, right? It's flipped that fast. It seems like every day that we wake up, every week, we see some new capability come into play, whether it's reasoning or it's small language models, that, where it just accelerates the usages and capabilities we see coming in.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think that's the real excitement with AI is the potential to innovate, as you're mentioning. I mean, how key to successful AI implementation is having the right hardware? And what do you believe it value that it adds?
Yeah, I mean, I think it starts with, it loops back to our initial conversation. The first thing when I talk to IT shops is, AI sounds great. You might even convince me I want these capabilities, but I want to start on a foundation that says, I have the security and privacy cover. Do I have the hardware fundamentals to do that? And so I think when I was talking earlier in the presentation about some of the security things, we've got that layer underneath to help protect, you know, the data as well as the privacy of those individuals. So we have that into play. Then it becomes, what kind of capability do I need? I hear AI PC, I hear Copilot Plus PC. How many TOPS do I need? You know, what do I need to have to make sure I'm kind of future-proofing as I go through? And we've made the decision that we want to lead here. We want to bring AI capability and Copilot Plus capability to more people. And so you'll see on our Ryzen AI 300 PCs that they have the Copilot Plus capability to offer all these experiences that we see Microsoft and others talking about. And it really gives you that headroom to be able to run these new experiences as they come in.
Yeah, that's absolutely correct. And we've discussed all these exciting possibilities and capabilities, I should say, but cost remains a major issue for IT leaders. What must they consider when trying to gauge where the best ROI lies, and how does AMD fit into that?
Yeah, I think it just starts with, what are the pain points that the customers have? What are they trying to solve for? And the great thing is we have a wide portfolio of products to choose from. If you watch some of the announcements at CES this year, we've got broad-based support. So if you're looking at, you know, HP and Lenovo, they've been great partners with us. We've now added Dell to have a broad portfolio of products as well. So we've got a lot of choice, not only in the spectrum and portfolio of our products, you know, that we produce, but from our partners as well. And then we give you the ability to scale, you know, from the bottom all the way up to the top. And some of our Halo products that are unmatched anywhere, from graphics capability, from some of the ability to run 70 billion parameter models. If you have content creators that are coming in, you've got the ability to do that. So really just kind of that breadth of capability, as well as really just balancing that with battery life, right? Making sure that's great if you have the performance, but if I have no battery life, that's a challenge. So really making sure that we have that all day battery life. And then it's really just fitting into your environment. Even if you have a great capability, if it's really disruptive to the business process that you have or operational process, it's a challenge to adopt those things. So obviously with AMD having the x86 capability, it's going to run all yesterday's apps, and then you're really set up for the future as well. So there's really no compromise, no big business process change from the software that you run, from the way you deploy and manage the PCs, from how you secure them. It just really bolts in and runs seamlessly.
Yeah, thank you, Michael. And I wonder if we can talk also about the other differentiators that mark out AMD in what is a very crowded and noisy AI PC marketplace right now.
Yeah, I think if you really take a step back, most IT shops are really looking for a technology partner, right? They're not looking for, hey, at this point in time, who has the highest benchmark, who's lower as you go through. Now, we do think we actually lead those benchmarks, but it's not a blip for us, right? We've made the investments as a company, not just on the client, but across the full portfolio. So we've got assets in what we're doing for IP with processors, to have leadership processors, not just at the client, but on the data center, right? We've made the investment in accelerators and graphics, again, not just for the client, but for discrete graphics cards, for accelerators in the data center. We've taken that NPU investment and we're spreading across for, you know, AI capability as well at the endpoint. And we're really leading at all those things, not just one point in time, but as we look out 3 or 4 years, this is a long-term plan. This isn't reactionary. This is, hey, we're leading now, and we believe we're going to be leading for the next 3 or 4 years. And we're a great technology partner for any IT shops that are looking to deploy PCs.
Yes, thank you. And we really have had a fascinating discussion going all the way through the different aspects of this AI PC emerging sort of technology that clearly is going to be top of mind, or certainly close to, for CIOs and IT decision makers. But as we come towards the end of the discussion, Michael, do you have like a final thought, a key point that you'd like to leave our audience with?
Yeah, I mean, I think the key point for us is we've tried to make it easy as we go through. We know it can be complicated, especially with these new technologies coming in. And so with our, you know, with our Ryzen AI 300 Pro systems, it's just commercial class, right? If you want the best performance, it's in there. If you want the best security, it's in there. If you want the best manageability, it's in there. If you want, you know, the best battery life, it's in there. If you want to make sure that you're set up for AI and you've got the foundation, it's there. So we're really trying to integrate those technologies in and just make it an easy button for IT to kind of look at and, hey, I know if I have this product, it's going to do all these different things and make it really easy for me. And then we're a trusted partner where, as you look forward, we're going to continue to improve and lead as we move forward. This isn't just this year we have a great product. It's for the next 3 to 4 years, we're gonna lead, we're gonna make it easy to integrate, and we're gonna have all that backwards, you know, capability. It's not gonna be a trade-off that I go through that's gonna drive operational friction or, you know, business process friction. It's gonna be simple as people transition and make the move. And then it's gonna put the power of the best performing PC with great battery life in the hands of end users, to allow them to do their job better, as well as just create. And that's in most cases where our employees offer the most value, is when they're focused on being able to create, you know, in their whatever their job is.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely right, Michael. That's probably a great place to leave it. You know, we are at the end of the CIO webcast with AMD on how to ensure PC fleet modernization in the AI era drives business success. Thank you to Michael for sharing his expert insight, and of course to everyone who watched. Goodbye.